Now, if you're an extremely clever woodworker, you can, of course, make your own box. There's nothing wrong with that. Just make sure your measurements are right. So you don't want to be making your own size jolly box. As a matter of fact, the length of the box is the most important part. You can make it as wide or as narrow as you want, but please just make them uniformed, because going forward, your life will be much more blessed. Anyway, I'm not that clever, so I just buy boxes. Now, I have bought boxes from all over the shop. I've got old boxes that I've resurrected out of the jolly heap of piles of bee equipment that's laying around my place. One thing I would say, if you're looking online, just try to buy boxes that are one piece of timber. It's very hard to tell, but it's normally reflected in the price. These are some Barnett bee boxes that I've got that are actually a whole solid piece of wood. Made from a pine tree, obviously, because it's a pine box. And the thickness is very important. So that's about 200 mils or 2 centimetres. So that thickness is a nice thing. But the fact that it's a piece of wood from one tree, I've bought boxes that were, I thought, wow, there's a bargain, I'll grab some of them. And of course, it was actually pieces of wood all glued together in segments. And so not good for life expectancy. Trust me on that. That's not a good option. And as per with everything else in life, what you pay for is what you get. And it just goes on and on. And you think after 55 years, a bloke would learn his lesson, but he's still getting caught out every now and then. So I'm telling you, don't do it. Go to a reputable bee box manufacturer. Order your boxes. Tickety-boo forever. Well, not forever, but of course you can get plastic boxes and all that. But let's not go there. But anyway, I like to use a bit of primer paint on the where my joins are going to be. Mainly because I found that if you have an old box that you've had around for lots and lots of years, so these parts start to absorb moisture, and that's where you can get rot to set in. I mean, there's nothing ideal about anything that you can possibly, but anything you can possibly do to make your boxes last a bit longer, I think it's a good thing. So I just like to put a little bit of pink primer on my edges and on these edges before I screw it together. So just a little bit on there so you can seal that edge off. Of course, you can use any sort of primer. I mean, it doesn't matter. I just like pink primer because it's got the old school lent like oils and stuff that seal the wood and actually make it feel nice. It's an oil-based product, though, so you have to actually make sure you've got some turpentine to clean your brushes. Now, you don't want to paint across the top, or you can paint across the top if you want, but you don't need to because that's actually where your frames are going to sit when we get to that point. But this will just give your box a little bit of love. Give it a bit more of a chance, you know. I mean, I don't know, boxes are now worth about $35 a pop, so the longer you can make them live, the better. Yeah, the professional league of beekeeping, they're getting all motivated and they'll make up the boxes and they'll wax dip them, and then the wax all oozes into these gaps and then that seals them off as well. So that's another thing, but because we're just doing a backyard tuitional, I'm figuring you're not going to have a wax dipper just yet. When you're doing lots of these, I guess you'd paint all your ends before you put it together so you don't have to get pink primer all over yourself, but I don't know. For the constraints of the show, I just like to do it all at once. And then it's wet and it goes together nice. And I'll tell you one other trick. This is a flat joint, but if you get the finger joints and you actually paint them with a bit of pink primer, and then when you whack them together, they go together nice. So you get yourself in all sorts of trouble if you let the paint set because you can't get the jolly box together. So, so just make sure that your handles are obviously up the right way. This seam is where your frame's going to sit, so you want to try and have that at the top. Get the other end out the way, and then you just want to stand up these side walls. Now, of course, there is jigs you can have to put your boxes together as well. You can stick the box in a jig and clamp it all up and get all excited. But I'm assuming you haven't got one of them, so we're going to go with this is the basic idea. This is reasonably important to get this thing square. And if you're lucky, you've bought a good quality box. You just want your seams to sit together. I like to screw my boxes because it's just easier to hold things. I've got plenty of boxes that are 50 years old and they were nailed with bloody nails this long, and heaven forbid. If you want a nail, you can nail. If you want a screw, you can screw. I don't know what else you can hold it together with, but I guess anything's possible. So here we go. So you just make sure you got it all lined up. I like to drill a little pilot hole. And you just get yourself a little screw, stick it there like that. Now, a trick for young players is you don't want to do the that whole side. Just do one screw in every piece, and then you can square it up as you get around the corner. Okay, so you just want to put one in the top. If you got all motivated and made a jig up, well, that good on you. But tell you what, if you're only making two or three boxes, it's probably not completely necessary. Then you just turn it around, try to keep it all together. Make sure you get this end, you want reasonably squared up. Drill another pilot hole so you don't snap everything. You probably, even though if you don't want to drill a pilot hole, you maybe don't need to with these modern screws, but I just like to do it, save the box splitting. Because, I mean, it's not really ideal, is it? You go to all the trouble of making a home for your lovely bees, you don't want it to be all drafty. Otherwise, I'll send you a complaint letter and say, what's going on? What do you mean you can't even get the box square? Right, so you've got the top four done, and then I like to flip it over. And then you just make sure you've got this all nice and squared up. It's pretty straightforward, because, I mean, you just run your finger along here and you can feel where the lips are. And you just want to hold that together. So pull that in, drill your next pilot hole, and so on it goes, until you get them all organised. Now, if you happen to have a box that's a bit warped, you can get yourself a clamp and hold it with a clamp and, of course, pull it all together. But if you're a little bit diligent, and you put a bit of force and push it so it'll actually stay nice and square, you should be pretty right, if the manufacturer has cut it right. Which you've gone to a reputable box maker, so it's gonna be fine, isn't it? Making bee boxes in my spare time. Things you do for a lazy Sunday afternoon, isn't it? Anyway, one thing for free, if you end up loving beekeeping, this is one of the jobs that you get to do a lot of, making boxes, because they do seem to multiply. Then I just like to make sure you've got the middle one, and I normally put that up on its edge so you can just check that it isn't bowed a little bit, because sometimes, I mean, obviously they've cut the wood when it's reasonably green, and so that's the only way they can get it through the mill anyway. And so sometimes it'll warp a little bit. So if you have your middle, have it up on its edge, so you can just check your middle bit, put a bit of weight on this. Now, of course, if you're all my father-in-law, you'd get all motivated and you'd measure where the middle of the thing is. But you know what? As my lovely wife would say, it's only a bee box. But if you want to be really excited and get it absolutely perfect, I'm sure you can measure it. When you're making, I don't know, several hundred of these, after a while, it doesn't really matter too much as long as they hold together. And the bees aren't completely fussed. They just don't want drafts. Pretty much, or the ability for someone else to attack them. 12. That should hold it together pretty good, I reckon. As you can imagine, after you make a few of these, you burn through a few screws. And there you have it, a home for your busy bees. And of course, then your frames all sit in here. And as I was saying, that's why that's recessed in here. So your frame's got something to sit on, and it's also below the lid. Now, of course, you've got to make yourself an entrance, and you've got to make yourself a base, because otherwise, you know, like, the bees might not know that they've got a house to stay in. It's not terribly advisable to cut a hole in your box to make your entrance, because you really are going to make life a little bit complicated for the ladies to get under the frames and make it a little bit... It just makes things not as streamlined as you should. So what my deal is, I get some 8mm little bits of, is that called dowel? I don't know what it's called, but 8mm of cut wood. I just go down the hardware store and buy these little strips. I'm sure if you were really motivated, you could cut them yourself, but hell, who could be bothered? So you basically want to make two sides. So you've got two the length of your box, which is around about 490 as a general rule. And then you want one piece at the back to make that cover in, and then you want two little bits across the front. Now, you can make that entrance, you know, really any size you like. I mean, you could not put the front bit on, but when they're, you know, going through winter, you don't want this doorway too massive. So you want to have a little bit of a gap. You don't necessarily want this the whole width of the box. Plus, it helps to support the when you put the base on here in a minute. Now, continue on with my theme of the pink primer. I like to put a bit of pink primer on the actual base of the box and also on my strips before I nail it all together. Just helps protect your wood, gives your box a fighting chance that maybe it'll bloom and live more than 10 years, but who knows? I mean, I'll pink prime this whole box once we get to the base on. I was just thinking, I reckon I've already painted my bases, so we might not see all that bit, but that won't matter. You'll probably buy a piece of particle board or marine ply or something. Please make it waterproof. I mean, goodness gracious. I mean, I guess you could actually even cut up some old floorboards if you had them laying around the place. You could do anything you like in a lot of respects. Because the ladies will live in a tree trunk if you're given half a chance. Obviously, you could get really motivated and have these all perfectly painted and you wouldn't have to play with them when they're wet. But where would be the fun in that? This is the whole point. You want to go in and see your wife or your husband or your partner and say, look, I've been busy in the shed. I haven't just been sitting out there drinking port, doing nothing. You need to get a bit dirty when it's a hobby, don't you? So you can prove you did something. So you sit that there for a minute. Hell, if you're really lucky, your partner will come out and help you paint. Oh, stranger things have happened. My poor wife, she gets sucked into helping me when it's swarming season because there's never enough boxes when all that's going on. But you probably won't need to worry about that in the short term. We'll cover that in a later episode, how to prevent your box from swarming. Well, at least slow them down. That's a little bit pretty. We'll nail this down before we get the front bit organised. Now try and keep your bead inside that lip so that the water doesn't run down and sit on this any more than it has to. Here we go, all covered in pink paint. The young cameraman was telling me a little story that he remembers from his childhood. I'd made this pergola in our backyard and I'd pink primed the wood. And then I was going to paint it, but of course I got busy doing something. And the lad asked me, well, that's an interesting colour, Dad. Why did you paint it pink? What the hell's that about? And I said, it's all right, son. It'll turn white soon enough. Because I was thinking in my head that it would turn white because I'll paint it white. Anyway, I'd forgotten all about that. And then the lad comes home from school after I'd painted the pergola. And says, wow, that took forever to turn white, that stuff. But you were right, it did go white. And I said, yeah, of course. I told you it would. But of course, as a grody up, I didn't realise that the lad had taken it completely seriously and thought that the paint did go white all by itself. If you're parenting out there, just clarify what you're on about, because, you know, sometimes your kids interpret things different to what you're thinking. Anyway, the boy still loves me. He's still filming. Here we are, we're having a conversation. One good thing about working together, you find out all these stories that you didn't even think about. Because as a parent, you've kind of got enough of your own madness going on. You don't need this to be ridiculous. There's just an 8mm gap, that seems to work. You can use a 12mm bit if you really want to get excited, but if you have too much gap under your frames, the ladies will fill it all in with wax and make another excitement for you. There's a trick for young players, and we'll just slap this bit on here. Now, for the sake of ease, I've already cut up some bases and painted them as well. So this is just a little bit of Weathertex or marine ply. That seems to work. I've already just painted the base of it a few times and sealed the edge. Make sure you seal the edge like everything else. And that's just going to become our baseboard. You don't need to paint this part that's inside the hive. I just painted the edge because that's going to sit on that lip. Plus, when you paint that edge, all the paint gets all here and you don't want it lumpy, you want it flat. Sit that there nice and square if you can. And then we're just going to nail that to the bottom of the box. So more nails, nails, nails and more nails. It just goes on the nailing. It's like a nail festival. Nailed it. Oh. Look at you go. Help, we both tell terrible jokes together now. If it's going to be sitting near your barbecue area where all your good mates are going to be able to look across and say, oh, that's your bee box, you probably need to take a bit more care and precision, and perhaps you can, you know, paint it fancy. So it's all relative to where it's going to be, actually. Main purpose of the exercise is to give the ladies somewhere to safe to live that's nice and cozy, and that you're able to work it. Because of course, as soon as you put bees in a box, all of a sudden, it's your responsibility to make sure they're healthy. And that's the fun part about being a beekeeper, is the fact you get to look after them and interact with them and see what they're doing, and it's fascinating. And the further you go, the more intriguing it all actually gets. Because every time you come back to your hive, you think, oh, I wonder what they're doing today. Now the next exciting bit, we have to make some legs so we can sit it on something. I was friends with a bloke that was doing up his table grape vineyard, and he pulled out all his old trellis work. And so I scored all these really lovely bits of redwood, which is kind of groovy because redwood's obviously going to last a bit longer being that it's sitting in the dirt. Of course, if you're in the, your beehive's going to be in your backyard, you're probably going to put it on a stand anyway, so it's not that imperative. But for when you're moving around in different sites and you sit these on the ground, a bit of redwood is very nice to have. A lot of times people will make the base of the hive longer and they'll stick it out the front as the landing board. But that's not particularly ideal, because what happens is when it rains, if you have got a little bit of an angle, all the water runs straight in your hive. And so what I like to have is you have your actual legs, which is wide enough, and it becomes your landing board as well as your leg. So that's a win-win situation, you could say. So you're going to have the leg on the back is going to be nice and square, flush with the back, because when you're sticking them in a pile, you want it nice and easy. And the leg at the front is not quite half, but probably a third sitting out. So the girls have got something to land on, and it also doesn't make the water run in your box as easy. So, there's always a trick to everything. So for this part of the project, you're going to need a little bit longer screws, of course, than the ones that I used to screw the box together, because you've got to get through the actual bottom, which is your base legs, and also into the box to keep it all together. So we're going to do the back one first. Now, as per with most things that I do, I like to drill a pilot hole, because I just think it just saves things splitting and just saves you a whole lot of headache. Helps if you have it going the right way around. That's not the healthiest sounding drill, is it? That's had a hard life. I think that's the one I burnt out when I was making some jelly candied honey. Well, not candied honey, creamed honey. I think that was not advantageous. Now these screws have got a little bit of a teeth part, so it'll cut in and make a nice flush fit. That saves you a bit of countersinking. If you're wondering why my box is wobbling a bit, it's not that the box isn't square, it's that the bench isn't square. My bench is a little bit like me, old and bent. Now, as I was saying, this is going to become your landing board. I normally try to go for about a third. Hell, I guess if you really got excited, you could measure it and get all pedantic. Maybe that'll be in the description, but I doubt it. Well, hopefully you're a bit handy with a few tools. Mind you, I'm pretty sure there is some website so you can just buy the thing already put together, or if you go down to your local bee shop, I'm sure there'd be an already constructed bee box that you could buy if you don't want to go to all this fun. But part of the fun of being a beekeeper is you get to try out your woodworking skills. Yes, and I know what you're thinking, my woodworking skills are not the best, but still, they get the job done. Oh, come on, behave. Oop, too good. Ta-da! So your bees have got their landing board, and you've also got this little lip here to help stop the water from running straight into your box. And that's a bit old school, but it works a treat. And there's the bottom. Now, if you're watching this in America, or perhaps actually anywhere other than Australia, you're going to be saying, heck, you know, how come he hasn't got his meshed for his Varroa mite? Well, praise God, down here in Australia, we haven't got Varroa mite yet. and we're not actually wanting to get it, but hell, it'll turn up. So if you happen to be living anywhere in the world other than Australia, you're probably going to really want a mesh bottom so you can actually control your mites a bit easier. The mites can fall through the hole here. When you ferment, when you fumigate your hive, you can catch them on this whiteboard, and then you can have a look as to how your mite infestation's going. Or, of course, that's a lot less complicated than the whole sugar shaking idea and all the rest of it. But Varroa mites we'll cover on another episode, and hopefully I'll never be able to show you what they look like. But due to the constraint of time, I've already painted these ones, so, you know, I've got my pink primer on the ends. I've even made them a fancy green colour. And, of course, if you're wondering what this is for, well, this is the other important part of your box. This is the lid. So you've got to keep the bees in the base, and you've got to keep the lid on the top. Otherwise, it's not going to be a box. It's just going to be, I don't know what it would be. It wouldn't be a bee box anyway, would it, without a lid? So what I've done, I've just cut a couple of lengths, the same length as the box. And then I've just cut some lengths of timber that are the length for the sideways part and recessed it a little bit so that they'll actually join up a bit nice. I mean, I suppose you don't have to make the recess, but I've done that with a little bit of... I've had that on my saw bench. I'm pretty sure you can do it by hand with your little wood saw, but anyway, you'll work that out, surely. We don't have to show you that, do we? I trust your ability. Right, and then we just sit that together. I've already got my pilot holes drilled, so we should just be able to screw it all straight together. Try to make sure you've kind of got it square. That's very helpful, otherwise it won't really sit on the top of your box properly. I'm a bit of a fan of screws because then you can pull stuff apart and put it back together, and I think they hold a bit better than nails. But if you don't want to use screws and you want to nail it, well, you can go right ahead. Because the good thing about beekeeping is you can get to make up a few of your own rules if you keep it all. Some of it you have to do the same, and others you can change up. Your screws will hold together a lot better than. A flat bench would have been a good idea too, wouldn't it, for this job? Hold that one there. Of course, if you'd had this manufactured by a professional, you probably would. My recessing is not completely perfect because I've just done it by hand. Oh, and we just thought I'd just double check before I nail the next bit on. That looks pretty good. You want a little bit of space here so you've got a little bit of airflow and the girls can run around. And I'll show you, we'll put a hive mat on top of the actual brood frames. You want a little bit of airflow here. Hey, if you're in the tropics and you want to get all excited, you should drill some holes here and let a bit more ventilation happen so the ladies can fan stuff. Here in the desert, well, it's not that imperative. I've got some lids with holes, some without holes, and it doesn't seem to make any difference to the ladies too much. So it just depends where you're living as to what you need to do. But mainly, if you're humid, you need more air to be able to flow. And then we want another piece of marine ply for the lid that I'd already painted, as I said, for the base. And that just sits on the top. Now, if you're really getting motivated and you're doing a lot of moving around, quite often the beekeepers will put a bit of tin on top of this as well. But if you're in your backyard, you probably don't need to get so as excited as to put the bloody tin on there. The tin's mainly to stop the actual wear and tear from when you put the other jolly legs on top of each other. Now, of course, the next question you have to ask yourself is what happens if there's a hurricane and the lid blows off? Well, there's a few ways to solve that problem. We've got some wire clips. We've got something called a hive lock. It just depends how you want to hold your lid on. But then, if the hurricane doesn't turn up within the first few weeks of you having a beehive, the ladies will stick the lid on for you, which is kind of cool. They'll get a bit of propolis and stick it around the top of the lid. Unless a crazy bear turns up, you're probably pretty safe. And what's more, I'm assuming it's going to be in your backyard, and you're probably not going to be picking it up and moving it too often. So maybe you won't need to worry about the actual locks and stuff. But... Oh, so there you have it. Your little home for your little ladies to all live in. Look at that. Tell you what. Next thing you know, you'll be making them by the hundreds. So this is something that's called a hive lock, which are kind of cool because you can adjust how long they're going to be. Oh, golly. You just slide it underneath. And then it's got these cool little teeth so it can decide how long it's going to be. And then, of course, when you put your super on, or your nut super, this will still all hold it all together. And it's that simple, really. And then your lid can't fall off. So, mind you, having said that, I have seen photos of a bear got into a bee yard and the bloody beehive ended up in the top of the pine tree. And I don't think that would have helped whatever happened then. So if you're in places where bears happen to live, perhaps think about a fence as well, because that might be a good option. Or I was watching this other show, the elephants in Africa. I thought, man, we haven't got any elephants here in Oz, but that would be fun with a bee box, wouldn't it? You'd bloody put his leg straight through the thing. So now that you've got your bee box put together, all you've got to do is give it a paint. Hell, if you really got excited, you can give it an oil, but paint's usually pretty good. Normally you want to do a prep layer, which is either pink primer or your 4-in-1 prep to seal your wood off, and then two top coats. And if you can use some sort of, see, that's one piece of advice that you should know, is please try to read the thing and make sure it's actually an outdoor paint, or external paint it'll be called, because if you put internal paint, it's not UV stable, and of course your bee box is going to be out in the UV, so you want to have external paint, and you want to use kind of bit more of the semi-gloss, so it's a bit harder and a bit stiffer. And of course you can pick any colour you like, just depends. I mean, generally the commercial boxes are all white, but hell, you can paint your box any colour you want. Me, every time I go to the hardware store, I wander through the paint section and try to buy all the messed up tinting stuff, because it's basically half price. So I've got yellow boxes and red boxes and blue boxes and goodness knows what other colour, and sometimes I've got some paint that I bought that I shouldn't have because it's too dally dark, but hell, anyway. So next time you're in your local hardware store, just wander down the paint aisle and they'll have mistinted paint. Grab yourself a tin of that and you'll be all amongst it. Oh, and don't forget, in Oz and probably everywhere else in the world, you've got to put a brand on your bee boxes so as that the people that are in charge of our lives and make sure that we're all doing the right thing know who you are and where you are. So you can either get, we've actually got a stencil made up that we can spray our thing on. I mean, I'm pretty sure if you're any good with a blooming bit of a paintbrush, you could probably paint your letters and your numbers on the thing. A lot of bigger beekeepers, and especially in New South Wales, they use a router and router their numbers in. Me, I haven't got a router. I've got a tin of spray paint and a jolly stencil, so that's where I'm at. So there you have it. That's how easy it is to make a bee box. You've made yourself a little home for somewhere between 60,000 and 160,000 little insects, and they're going to love you, give you some honey, and you've got them all safe and housed here. And next week we'll show you what has to go inside your box so you can actually bloom and work your bees and make things happen. And you know what, you can check your brood and how everything else needs to be looked at in your box. And if you're enjoying this journey of beekeeping in your backyard, why don't you click down onto the Patreon support page? Hell, I don't know, I think at $10, I think you get to join the Q&A and become part of the club. And who knows, if you want to get into it seriously and give us more than $10, there's all sorts of other cool rewards and incentives. And hell, I'm pretty sure the lad's got me stitched up to give honey to a fair few people around the planet. Even if you're not a Patreon supporter and you're a subscriber, which is great, and you're sharing our content, make sure and everybody can get to know what beekeeping is and how much that can be enjoyed. Thank you very much for watching. Anyway, next week we're on to frames. Ha, we're on to the pointy end of the project now.